Morning, everyone. I want to start the morning off with the Howard Virchow Lecture by having Klaus Pirok, who I think everyone knows from the many years, the 15 years that we've been having the Virchow Lecture. I think Klaus has introduced the lecture every year. And this year, our guest this morning, Dr. Kapoor from Tufts University, Peter will introduce him. But I'd like to have Klaus say a few words about the marvelous Howard Virchow.
My pleasure to do so. We started the Howard Virchow Lecture 15 years ago when Howard was still alive because we wanted him to know how much we revered him. Howard Virchow was the first director of the Division of Cardiology at the university, and when he retired from the university in 1971, he came down here to Abbott Northwestern and became sort of the reigning cardiologist who was instrumental in starting the Minneapolis Heart Institute. It was a pleasure to work with Howard Virchow, who was much more than a cardiologist, really truly a physician of the finest nature, and it was a pleasure to go on rounds with him and to see how he connected with patients instantly. So it gives me immense pleasure to turn over microphone to our lecturer today. No first to be introduced. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for joining us. It is my pleasure today to introduce Dr. Naveen Kapoor. He's an associate professor in the Department of Medicine in the Division of Cardiology. I'm going to read fast because we've got a lot to say here. He's a busy guy. He's the executive director of the Cardiovascular Center for Research and Innovation, director of the Acute Circulatory Support Program, director of the Interventional Research Lab, and of the Cardiac Biology Research Center at Tufts Medical Center. He is dual certified in both interventional cardiology and advanced heart failure and transplant cardiology. He's had several mentees that have received Young Investigator Awards from ACC, HFSA, AHA, and the Northwestern University Young Investigator Forum. His expertise is on invasive hemodynamics, mechanical circulatory support, complex coronary intervention, and interventional therapies for patients with heart failure. He has founded several clinical and research fellowships at the Tufts Medical Center, including the Robert Kung Interventional Heart Failure Fellowship Program. And as we were talking on the way over here, it's funded for at least the next 4 years. So they've had, I think, 10 graduates, he said, already, and have been very busy and very much in demand. He is on multiple national committees, AHA, ACC, HFSA, and SCAI. His research focuses on large animal models of acute and chronic heart failure, circulatory support device development, and cardioprotective mechanisms in the setting of acute MI. His laboratory was the first to identify that acute mechanical unloading of the LV activates a cardioprotective signaling program in the setting of acute MI, and is the principal investigator of several trials involving acute mechanical support, including the DORA unloading trial, testing the safety and feasibility of LV unloading prior to reperfusion in ST segment elevation MIs. His basic science laboratory focuses on molecular mechanisms governing maladaptive cardiac remodeling, and he has particular expertise in TGF-beta system. Over the last 7 years, his laboratory has published several papers focused on a TGF-beta co-receptor known as endoglin, and was the first to establish that reduced endoglin activity improves survival and limits maladaptive cardiac remodeling. His laboratory further demonstrated that targeting this using an antibody-mediated approach not only limits the development of fibrosis, but can reverse established fibrosis in preclinical models. More recently, his laboratory was the first to identify a functional role for bone morphogenic protein 9 in heart failure. He is the inventor of several patents focused on heart failure device and drug therapy development, and is the recipient of grant funding from the NIH, AHA, and several industry sponsors. We are very pleased to have Dr. Naveen Kapoor here today to educate us on a fraction of what he knows. Thank you, Naveen.
Mouse works as well. Perfect. Great. This on? Okay, great.
Thanks so much for coming out, and thanks so much for inviting me to give this lecture, and thanks for the introductions. I had a lot of fun reading about Howard Virchow this weekend and on the flight over, and learned an immense amount. I can't learn all of it, but I certainly went as far back as I could
to try to learn about Howard and all the work that he did, and it was just absolutely astounding. So I'm hopeful that this lecture at least comes up to a little bit of where Howard was when he was at the peak of his career. And certainly, thanks again for having me out here for this lecture. So I'm going to be talking about ventricular unloading, state of the art, and some future directions. This lecture is going to span sort of clinical all the way over to basic science, and then we're going to come back to clinical again. That's that classic Johns Hopkins paradigm of going one step more basic, which some of us are very familiar with. So I thought actually that, you know, one of the papers that I did pull of Howard Burchill was actually this paper from Circulation 1971. This was in January, and this is a very special issue, and you're going to see a lot of links between the 1970s and the contemporary thought around ventricular unloading. So this was a very particularly important issue. You'll see why in the lecture. But in this issue, they were talking about Howard stepping down as editor of Circulation. He had been editor for about 5 or 6 years. He had done a phenomenal job. And the way they wrote this very respectful and honorable letter to him, basically thanking him, was really highlighting what he did uniquely. And what he did uniquely was he linked pathology, physiology, basic science, all back to clinical cardiology, and that's not easy to do. And so I think for that reason, a lot of the work that he did, you know, has now been basically the template for many of us going forward. And so you'll see why this January issue is particularly important, but it's an honor to give this named lecture. So one of the things that we all focus on is the patient with heart failure. And so whether you're an interventional cardiologist, whether you're a structural interventionalist, whether you're a general cardiologist, an imager, or a heart failure specialist, you're going to engage with patients who have heart failure. And this is a particular patient of mine who went through the saga of acute MI heart failure and shock. Back in 2007, this was one of the first LAD PCIs that showed up at Tufts when I was just starting as a junior attending that had an anterior MI, got a balloon pump, was in cardiogenic shock. He survived the hospitalization, but went on to then have subsequent admissions for recurrent heart failure, ended up getting a defibrillator. A few years later, came back for multivessel high-risk PCI, which was Impella-supported, and then subsequently lived on to have more recurrent episodes of heart failure. Until finally, about 10 years later, he showed up back in the hospital with cardiogenic shock and biventricular failure. Now he's a dilated cardiomyopath requiring an Impella and ECMO, this ECPella combination, which back in 2017 was just coming around. And then really could not wean off the pumps and ended up getting onto bilateral Centromags, stayed on Centromags for a period of 5 months in the hospital until he ultimately got a transplant. And so this is not an atypical story for a patient with heart failure who starts off with an acute MI, goes on to have undulations of recurrent heart failure, and shock at its initial presentation as well as at this endpoint of dilated cardiomyopathy. So one of the things that we're going to talk about today is this concept of ventricular load. And so I think it's a fundamental principle that we all should be familiar with. Ventricular wall stress is a major determinant of clinical outcomes. And wall stress in its most fundamental formula, as we all think back to undergrad, is the law of Laplace. It's pressure and volume inside a chamber, which translates to pressure and radius, normalized to LV mass. So in the acute MI setting, there is an acute load, which becomes very important clinically, and we'll talk about that in a moment. And then in dilated cardiomyopathy, this law of Laplace and this wall stress starts to become even more prominent in driving the physiology and driving clinical outcomes. So when people talk about load, and I get this question all the time, is what is ventricular load? And so load refers to any variable that increases myocardial oxygen consumption. So anything that increases demand on the ventricle. And so that would be heart rate, it would be wall stress, it would be pressure inside the ventricle, whether it's systolic or diastolic, and it would be the workload of the heart, the stroke work that the heart is performing. Now, myocardial oxygen supply we're quite familiar with. This is one of the plenary institutions for coronary revascularization and CTO. And so we know about coronary occlusions, multivessel disease, and we also know about collateral blood flow and microvascular dysfunction. But this side is less familiar, especially on the interventional side. But for the heart failure physicians, this is every day at the office is dealing with reductions in wall stress. So when we think about pioneers in our understanding of ventricular load, it goes all the way back to the 1800s with Otto Frank, Ernest Starling, went on to Carl Wiggers, Arthur Guyton. And then there are a series of actually Japanese physicians who were pioneers in this field. They actually came over from Japan and spent a number of years at Johns Hopkins where they started to develop some of the fundamental biology and physiologic concepts around ventricular load. And then all of these were actually trainees of each other. They were all colleagues. And then Dave Cass and Dan Burkhoff are the most modern representation of the ventricular load physiologists. And back in 1975, around that Howard Burchill area, this was the understanding. This was the new concept of pressure volume area. So this is the pressure and volume inside of a ventricle. And these physiologists had started to unravel the mechanics of the heart. They basically learned about end-systolic pressure volume relationships for contractility and diastolic pressure volume relationships. But more importantly, they started to link this concept of physiologic mechanical pumping to a biologic effect. And what they started to realize was that, this mechanical work actually costs oxygen. And that when you think about the oxygen cost, the burn rate is mostly spent in the myocyte around cross-bridge cycling. It's around endothelial and cardiac coupling. And then there's this basal metabolism which occurs in the heart with every heartbeat. And so this was back in 1975, which is really an astounding level of science for them to penetrate into. And 40 years later, it's the same fundamental principles. Now we're in color. Now it looks very pretty. Now we're on Harvey. We're on Teach apps. You can see these on videos and YouTube and Khan Academy, you name it. But at the end of the day, the workload of the heart is still very much mechanical work. And then there's calcium cycling and then there's basal metabolism that has started to become a little bit more clear. But not too much has changed in the concept of load. Now, for the heart failure physicians, we know that adverse cardiac load adverse cardiac remodeling is load dependent. So after an infarct is completed, the infarct zone expansion, the spherical ventricular dilatation that starts to impact the law of Laplace, this is a fundamental principle of cardiac remodeling. And we know that if you give drugs like ACE inhibitors, they have a direct myocyte effect, but they also have a hemodynamic effect. And if you withdraw those ACE inhibitors, then patients actually start to get worse again, and they start to redilate. So this loss of function, gain of function mechanism comes into play. And so this concept of ventricular remodeling, I think, was best illustrated when we start to think about any drug or device and how it impacts patients with heart failure. If you can reduce ventricular volume, you should actually be seeing better outcomes for patients if it's sustained. Now, in acute MI, this is also a science that is probably a little bit less well understood, but acute load still links to poor outcomes in STEMI. So these were some of the early studies. This is from Ajay Curtain. And then more recently from Adnan Kastradi and his group, showing that an LVEDP greater than 18 at the time of a STEMI is actually associated with worsening heart failure, worsening infarct size, and these are some of the early findings suggesting that load may be impacting outcomes. And then we also know from a more recent analysis from Greg Stone and his group that if a patient shows up with an anterior MI or any STEMI and has an LVEDP above 24, all of a sudden mortality starts to get impacted. And in fact, it's fairly early mortality. It's when those first 3 months, but then this is sustained over the next 24 months. So the concept of load and outcomes still holds true, even the acute load setting for acute MI. Now, this goes back to the 1970s again, and so you're going to see this theme throughout the talk. But at the end of the day, Forrester, Diamond, and Swan came up with a classification in 1977 that basically indicated that load is bad if you're having an acute MI, but it's worse if you're in cardiogenic shock. And if you just look at the parameters for cardiac index, wedge pressure, and mortality, for patients who have low filling pressures and normal cardiac output, this anterior MI or STEMI outcomes are about mortality of 3%. But if you start to get to the point where you have a low cardiac index and you start to have load, increased LVEDP, now you're up to 51%, and this is that shock population. So this concept that load is still a target of therapy, I think, has been established back in the 1970s. And more recently now, 40 years later, now 2017, this is the consensus statement from AHA that we put out a couple of years ago. And essentially, you're back to Killip and Forrester. We're still looking at wedge pressure. We're still looking at cardiac index. We've now put it into a color 2x2 table. But essentially, this is Killip and Forrester 40 years later. It hasn't changed that much in terms of our thinking about how load impacts outcomes in AMI or cardiogenic shock. Now, what has changed since the 1970s is the development of a lot of technologies. There are a lot of different devices, and Peter, as we were talking about on the way over here, you guys implement, I think you rattled off at least 7 pumps between Rotaflow, CardioHelp, Centromag, Impella, Protec Duo, you name it. The technologies for ventricular unloading have really started to accelerate and come into our practice. But still, the fundamentals of load, I think, are still missing. And that's where we've really taken a deeper dive into this concept before we get into unloading. But when we do think about ventricular unloading, this is now quite simply a anything that refers to a reduction in myocardial oxygen consumption or demand while maintaining systemic perfusion. And so anything that can reduce heart rate, wall stress, intracardiac pressures, or stroke work, you're now going to start to target myocardial oxygen demand or consumption. And the spectrum of AMCS devices you can see here, some of them we talked about this morning, and some are still investigational. We're seeing many, many more come out in the startup community in this field as well. And so about, 10, 15 years ago, we started studying these technologies, especially as they related to fundamental physiology. How do they impact pressure volume? How do they impact that PVA that we talked about from the 1970s? And we started looking at the Impella device, the tandem heart device, and we started to learn that, if you can get a reduction in volume and pressure inside the ventricle, then you're starting to get that true effect of reducing pressure volume area and could potentially reduce oxygen consumption. And with the tandem heart device, we're seeing a very nice effect on volume, and so you can still get that reduction in pressure volume area in total, but from a different mechanism. That's a preload reducing device. And what we've also learned is that, this transvalvular pump concept actually is probably one of the more efficient ways of reducing pressure and volume inside the ventricle. As you can imagine, it's similar to an LVAD except without the apical coring. And one of the things that we started learning, which was very interesting, is that when this pressure volume loop starts to melt away with activation of a transvalvular pump, it now becomes triangular in shape. So you lose isovolumic contraction, you lose isovolumic relaxation, which are the energy consuming components of each cardiac cycle. And so this triangular shape is the sine qua non of an LVAD that performs unloading. And now you can see that with transvalvular approaches. And the other thing that is also important is that we've started introducing the concept of an HQ curve now to the interventional community. Now, the HQ curve is a mechanical operating principle for pumps. And essentially, device flow is equal to the RPMs you dial in and out, but it's inversely related to the transvalvular gradient across the aortic valve. And so, for example, a patient coming in with normal blood pressure, you can expect that at this point, this transvalvular gradient, 80 minus 5, let's say, in diastole, you'll get this amount of flow. But as soon as you start to become acutely ischemic or you start to develop cardiogenic shock, this transvalvular gradient starts to become very narrow. And when this denominator goes down, the device flow actually starts to become more important, starts to go up. And so if you've got a pretty flat HQ curve, you've got a very interesting dynamic of basically becoming more functional from a pump perspective the more dysfunctional the ventricle is. And this is why we see a lot of this data coming out for transvalvular unloading and cardiogenic shock. Now, there are a lot of investigational technologies coming out. This is a HeartMate PHP device that we've been studying for a number of years now. We, along with my co-PIs, we started this PHP SHIELD II trial in 2015. There was a trial suspension in 2017 and then reinitiated back in 2018 again. And this is now another transvalvular technology with a self-expanding impeller that comes across the aortic valve and gets open to about 18 French sitting here across the aortic valve. And what we're seeing is that the flow register can get us up to that 5.0 plus liter range. So now we're seeing 6 liters of flow from a device that's deployed through a 14 French sheath in the femoral artery. And so this is now kind of opening up that concept of transvalvular loading. It is interesting to note that even the pumps themselves are load dependent. So if you start to have higher SVR, then actually this can start to impact the amount of flow you get through a device. So if you pick one of these isobars, let's say we set it at 4,000 RPM, at an SVR of 500, you'll see this amount of flow. But at an SVR of 2,000, you'll see almost about a liter reduction in flow. So the devices themselves are also load dependent and can be impacted by afterload. And nowhere is this more important than when we start to combine rotary flow pump technology, transvalvular pumps, with ECMO. And I think this is something that we've learned clinically from taking care of our ECMO patients, especially if we're using it in combination with a transvalvular pump. So we know that ECMO works by basically taking blood from the venous system, putting it through an oxygenator, and then pressurizing the arterial tree. So that it can reduce preload, it can also increase afterload. And so this concept of should we combine this with a transvalvular pump has become quite in vogue. Now, if you're sitting here as a transvalvular pump, the two things you don't want are a reduction in preload and an increase in afterload. Both of those could actually impair the function of the transvalvular pump. So when we see this, and this slide now has been shown quite a bit, but this is a very simple Langston catheter measuring LV and AO pressure simultaneously. And what you see here is that with activation of ECMO, you get a very nice increase in blood pressure. And that's really what you're trying to do when you're salvaging someone either with ECPR or with cardiogenic shock. And one of the things that we've also been looking at is this is not on the operating curve. So as you see here, this delta P, as we talked about for transvalvular pumps on ECMO, starts to increase. And so if you're a transvalvular pump, now the denominator number is going up. And so the device flow may also change on that HQ curve. You may be sliding up the HQ curve and seeing less flow coming out of that transvalvular pump. So this is a nice concept paper from Mark Dickstein. And Mark was trying to figure out how often do we need to vent with ECMO? Do you always need to vent? I've had, you know, folks get up and say, I never vent, ever. And then other folks say, I always vent, always. And so that's another nice debate, Tim, that we can put into the TCT sessions for next year when we're doing the planning. But I think that, you know, one of the things that we've noticed is that this actually holds true. I think the pre-ECMO initiation EF and also the change in the increase in mean arterial pressure may actually start to predict when you're going to expect an increase in your LVDP. So if you see your MAP jump by about 30 or 40 points in an EF that's about 10%, you're going to expect that that's a load, that's an acute load imposed on the ventricle, and that's when the EDP might start to climb. But if you're talking about a MAP that goes from 70 to 90, and you've got an EF of about 30, 40%, you may not see that load. So I think these two parameters are potentially helpful for folks to try to figure out where to vent and where not to vent. But we are seeing emerging data that the combination of ECMO with some sort of vent, and we've seen this for balloon pump as well, is actually leading to better outcomes. And so this, again, starts to point at this concept of left ventricular decompression or unloading in the setting of use of ECMO in cardiogenic shock. Now, one of the other things we're starting to see also is some data coming out about timing. And so early initiation of mechanical support, I think whether it's ECMO, whether it's Impella, whether it's Tandem, as long as you're getting people on support and the right support strategy, it's probably going to lead to better outcomes. And this is an observational study from Bill O'Neill that was from some time ago. And now this is coming out across more registry data. You're seeing CVAD. You're seeing independent universities show that this concept of early initiation of mechanical support may lead to better outcomes. And again, I think this is actually data that's probably going to end up being device agnostic, especially for cardiogenic shock. So when we think about best practices for shock, you know, some of the stuff that I try to summarize it in one slide, but some of the things we look at are primarily collecting hemodynamic data, looking at metabolic data is critically important. Lactate kinetics has become a really important GPS trigger for us in terms of figuring out if we're in the right direction or not. Are we getting lactate washout? The support profile, what type, what level of support, are they actually responding to the mechanical support is critically important, and that requires a PA catheter. Revascularization status, of course, but probably one of the most important common denominators for shock outcomes with acute MCS is vascular safety. And so this is actually a real challenge because of large bore cannulas with Impella also maintaining that Impella position and then also making sure that you've got perfusion to the distal legs. So that's a little bit about the clinical space of loading. We've talked about, you know, ventricular load from some of the clinical data going all the way back to Forrester and all the way back to some of the fundamental concepts from Sunagawa and some of the early pioneers in load. But let's get back to our patient. And one of the questions we've always been asking in our laboratory is, can we change the trajectory of this patient's life? Can we change the saga that this patient went through with undulations of heart failure after their initial presentation with acute MI? And so, you know, to understand this concept, actually there's a very nice review from Doug Mann back in 2012, which talks about the deformation of ductile materials. He's taking another bioengineering principle, and he's looking at stress and strain. But what they describe is an elastic region and a plastic region. And so when we think about this concept of unloading, there's a lot of science in unloading for dilated cardiomyopathy, which really actually exists right on this teetering edge of getting into the plastic region, where you may not get reversibility of damage that's already been set in and stayed there for a long time. Those thin dilated ventricles are unlikely to recover, mostly because they've lost their contractile reserve. But on this elastic slope, this elastic region, this is where some of this damage could be reversible. And this is more relevant to the acute MI or acute populations when they start to come in. And this starts to get towards this concept of instead of triggering myocardial remission with mechanical unloading, such as an LVAD, now can we start to get to myocardial recovery? And that, again, comes at an earlier phase in the injury cascade. So this is why I linked it back to Howard Burchell. So January 1971, that was the issue, and the editorial in that issue was about Howard's leaving as circulation editor. But one of the last papers that Hauer actually was the editor for was this paper by Morocco and Brunwald. And this classic paper from the same issue in 1971 was the first one to indicate that if you actually could reduce myocardial oxygen demand, you might actually change the trajectory of a patient's life who's having an infarct. And that actually you could potentially reduce the size of the infarct, and then of course that infers subsequent development of heart failure. And so this early pioneering concept for Morocco and Brunwald was introduced back in 1971, but at the same time there weren't really great techniques for reducing demand at that time. You know, they had some medications at that point, but not really an effective way to do it for an acute MI patient. And then just a few years later, this guy was walking around the AHA basically showing his pig data, and this was Andreas Grunzig showing his angioplasty concept. And so 1976, just 5 years later, is at the AHA, and then 1 year later is the first human coronary angioplasty. And this, of course, changed the trajectory of the field. And now the field for acute MI management really focused on the supply side. There's a lot less interest in demand at this point, primarily, again, because there were limited therapies that could target demand. So I think at the end of the day, we've learned over the years, over the decades, that in STEMI, timing is everything. And what that means is that for every 30-minute delay or increase in ischemic time, what you can expect is an increase in one-year mortality by 7.5%. What you can also expect for every 30-minute delay in ischemic time is an increase in infarct size by about 30 to 40%. So for these reasons, and these are the two classic papers from DeLuca and Tarantini, we are myopically focused on reducing door-to-balloon times and reducing ischemic time as much as possible. Now, what we've also learned is that in the contemporary era, heart attacks still are leading to heart failure. And actually, for every 5% increase in the size of a heart attack, we know that one-year survival goes down by 20%, and we also know that one-year development of heart failure hospitalization, goes up by 20%. And so what this tells us is that even with primary PCI, about 18% of your LV becomes infarcted during an acute MI. And with every 5% increase, we're seeing that trigger an increase in heart failure. Now, for 40 years, actually, for LV unloading science, this again goes back to the 1970s. Back then, the technology was the balloon pump. And so a lot of the early work for ventricular unloading in this space was done with IABP. But at the end of the day, after 40 years of work, what we've learned is that you have to have adequate LV unloading, and you have to initiate it before reperfusion. And we'll talk about why that is in just a moment. But if you can actually reduce the myocardial oxygen demand before reperfusion, just like Brunwald had indicated in 1971, you could potentially reduce infarct size. And for 40 years, this has been a holy grail that people have been chasing after. And we've been chasing after it in clinical trials. So the CRISP AMI trial was one of the first trials of an attempt at ventricular unloading in acute MI. And what they focused on were patients with anterior MI without cardiogenic shock who had pre-reperfusion insertion of an intra-aortic balloon pump. And what they showed was that there was essentially no change in clinical outcomes, and also that there was a trend towards a slight increase in the infarct size in the IABP group. But forget about the IABP group for a moment. It's still astounding that about 37.5% of the LV is infarcted with an anterior stem in contemporary practice. And you know, these are trial sites. These are some of the better sites out there for clinical practice. And so we learned that IABP is probably not sufficient in terms of the unloading side. And so, or maybe this whole idea doesn't make sense. So around the same time, we were working with a tandem heart device, which is a left atrial to femoral artery bypass pump. And what this pump does is, as we showed you, it reduces ventricular volume. So it reduces that pressure volume area pretty quickly. But we knew that putting in a tandem with all the transseptal cannulas, it's going to take about 15 to 30 minutes before you can get to the coronary and then open up the artery. So in the preclinical models, we intentionally placed a 30-minute delay from initiation of pump unloading to reperfusion, just to account for what might happen in the cath lab. And so this group actually had about 150 minutes of LAD occlusion versus 120. And what we saw was that with ventricular unloading, this reduction in stroke work or wall stress, that there was about a 50% reduction in infarct size. And so this was one of the earlier studies saying that if you can actively unload the ventricle before reperfusion and potentially even take your time to get to reperfusion, you might actually get a reduction in that infarct size, which again is what's targeting that link to the clinical outcomes. So we attempted a trial. This was the TRIST trial, tandem heart to reduce infarct size trial. And the TRIST trial was this idea of putting in a tandem transseptal puncture, 21 French cannula, in the middle of an anterior STEMI. And so as a result, there was zero enrollment. And I think that sites that said they would participate started to realize that this probably is not a good idea. And this, at the end of the day, was an engineering limitation. We couldn't really test the concept of unloading. So around the same time, you know, the Impella group had reached out to our lab and said, well, can you do the same thing with an Impella? Because we think we can put it in quicker and we can unload as effectively. And I said, well, we're happy to test out the question. But if we're going to test it out, we're actually very interested in this delay concept. So we actually said in this group, we're going to put a 60-minute delay. So we put the Impella in, and then we wait 60 minutes before reperfusing, compared to the control arm, where it just had 90 minutes of ischemic time. So really, what we should have seen is a significant increase in the infarct size based on that 30-minute but now 60-minute delay to infarct. And what we found was that with a nice 50% reduction in wall stress, we again saw a linear reduction in infarct size. So again, suggesting that on this elastic region of Dugman's model, we're now beginning to see that myocardial recovery effect in the acute setting. Now, we have more recently started to test whether ECMO can do the same thing, because I think this is a natural extension. So if we were to rapidly put someone on ECMO, now this doesn't give us the unloading, but do we actually see that we could still do the same thing by increasing blood pressure? And what we found actually was that ECMO is not reducing infarct size. This was comparing no pump versus Impella unloading versus ECMO. And we saw actually that there was actually an increase in infarct size. And when you look at the infarct, you can see here this white pattern within the red area at risk. It's actually a fairly dense white pattern. And that's a really interesting observation for us, because we don't think it's just about quantity of infarct. We think it's also about the quality of the infarct. And we also see here and then in the control group that there's also this very white, dense infarct that's almost transmural in these models. But what we see here in the Impella group is actually that there's interspersed areas of white mixed in with red. And so we were beginning to start to think about why is that happening? And we see it very consistently, this sort of disruption of the transmurality of an infarct. And so are these actual islands of surviving myocytes, or is this just a staining artifact? And so we started to look at some of the underlying mechanisms of unloading in the acutamide setting. And we talked about, you know, this concept of reducing oxygen consumption. That's sort of the 101 mechanism. But one of the other things that started us thinking about this further was this idea of this fractionated transmural infarct. We know from some of the modeling that's come out from Dan Burkoff is that with transvalvular unloading, you should see an increase in MAP and a reduction in LVDP. So maybe this transmyocardial perfusion gradient starts to increase. But we took this a little bit further, and we actually borrowed from some of the CTO physiology work. And we started to measure something called the pressure-derived collateral flow index. And so what this means is that during an LAD occlusion, we would have a Doppler wire and a pressure wire or a combo wire down the LAD in the occluded bed, the area at risk. And what we are measuring is the distal occlusion pressure or coronary wedge pressure normalized to the central aortic pressure. And if you start to see an increase in this wedge pressure, it can't be coming from the LAD itself. It has to be coming from somewhere else. And so is it coming from a collateral vessel from a neighboring non-culprit target? And what we started to see was that actually when we started transvalvular unloading, the collateral flow index actually starts to increase. And it actually increases to a point that this territory is now minimally ischemic. And so the idea is that by putting in a transvalvular unloading pump, we were actually seeing that one of the first effects before epicardial reperfusion was that we were actually shutting off ischemia or turning down the ischemic burden. And that might be the supply-demand mismatch, which is becoming more normalized. So we started looking at this change in collateral flow index, and we found actually that this correlates also with stroke work or that unloading effect. So the unloaded groups are down here, the control groups are here, the ECMO groups were up here. And when we started to compare this to infarct size, we again saw that an increase in the collateral flow index correlates with a reduction in infarct size. And so this starts to really get to this concept of increasing perfusion of the area at risk without the need for epicardial reperfusion. And I think that's, again, another paradigm change that we're beginning to see. And this is just an illustration that even if you reperfuse and you infarct 50% of the area at risk, if you can shrink the area at risk, this red circle, down by 50%, now you've already reduced the impact of reperfusion injury. But one of the fundamental biologic principles of reperfusion injury comes back to a very complex signaling cascade. And this was actually put out again by Bob Kloner and Eugene Brunwald in a classic editorial in Circulation called The Double-Edged Sword of Reperfusion. And the concept is that as soon as you become ischemic, you start to disrupt oxidative phosphorylation and ATP synthesis. And so this occurs in the mitochondria. And when you start to reperfuse vessels, you're actually beginning to accelerate that injury by opening up the mitochondrial permeability pore, and that leads to worsening cell death and necrosis. So there's an ischemic phase where your myocardium is probably stunned, and this is potentially reversible. And then there's a damage phase where you actually get this hypercontracture of the myocardiomyocytes, and this is irreversible. Again, that timing element, very much like shock, comes into play. And there's a whole signaling cascade that gets involved. But one of our questions was, can we stop this myocardial injury clock before you get into this irreversible phase? And so we started taking a deeper dive into the biology of mechanical unloading. And one of the best ways to do this is actually to do this in a blinded way. So we actually handed off all of our samples to an outside core lab, which runs a lot of transcriptomic and genomic profiles. And they ran basically the entire transcriptome for pigs, about 30,000 genes. And they then use a computer to just simply cluster the samples as to whether or not they cluster together or not. And this was the clustering heat map that came back to us. And this was one of the first signs we're probably on the right track. When we look at the sham or uninjured ventricle, you see a gene pattern for about these 3,000 genes that shows red here and blue here. With primary reperfusion, it's almost reversed. And so these are the genes that have the significant p-value in terms of change. And we see that actually the blue is here and the red is here. And when you actually start to perform this unloading effect, you now actually start to see a pattern that shifts from here back towards that uninjured ventricle. And this was, again, that sign is, why are we seeing this cardioprotective effect? And so we started looking at the biology of reperfusion injury, and some of the canonical pathways are shown here through a signaling receptors or downstream kinases. But at the end of the day, it comes down to mitochondrial integrity. Are the mitochondria still intact in these cardiac myocytes? And we've come up with a number of observations basically identifying some of these cardioprotective cytokines that we published last year. But this question of mitochondrial integrity still remained open for us. So we started looking at scanning EMs and transmission EMs as well as the mitochondria, trying to understand how are the mitochondria changed. And with primary reperfusion in the infarct zone, this is what the mitochondria look like. Instead of being these tightly packed circles with cristae all the way through them, you actually see these swollen circles with blebs forming, and some of them have ruptured. And so we see that sort of mitochondrial death pattern that we just talked about for the double-edged sword of reperfusion. But in the unloading group, we were seeing more and more mitochondria that were staying intact. And the question is, why is that? And again, is this just another artifact of a transmission or scanning EM? So to do this, we had to actually go back and go one step more basic than we had already done with some of the signaling pathways. And we had to understand how mitochondria work. And this gets back to the electron transport chain. So before you grab your pillows, and take a look at the phone, just take a moment and come back to med school with me, because I had to do the same thing. So it turns out that there's an impeller sitting in your mitochondria, and this motor is actually ATP synthase. Okay, it's complex 5, and this motor is driven by a proton gradient that's sitting here inside the mitochondrial matrix, here to the inner mitochondrial membrane. And when you become ischemic, the first thing that happens is that gradient disappears and the motor stops spinning. So if you're trying to find out if you're impacting ischemia, the first thing to figure out is, are you still generating ATP and are the complexes still functioning? And this is before you have any injury. Now, the reason why the motor functions properly is that sitting next to this ATP generator is basically a series of complexes. So it's almost like an industry plant. It's like a working model. Where basically these complexes function primarily to drive protons into the matrix. And so by driving them into the matrix, you create a gradient that drives the proton-driven motor, and that generates more ATP synthesis. And so fairly simple at that level in terms of how this works. Now, what we've also started understanding is these complexes are essential for energy biogenesis in the heart. And actually, if you look at the complexes, what they do is they transfer electrons through coenzyme Q and cytochrome C over to complex 4, and that maintains this proton-driving gradient. It's what keeps the gradient alive, keeps the mitochondria alive, keeps your myocyte alive. And inside complex 1 in particular is where we see the most efficient turnover of electrons through redox states to generate this proton gradient. So complex 1 actually is a linchpin for ischemic injury. If complex 1 is dysfunctional, then your cardiac myocyte's likely to die at that point. So we actually performed a number of molecular techniques, but one of them that's actually fairly simple is this idea of performing a mitochondrial stress test. So we isolated mitochondria from the center of the area at risk, the infarct zones that you saw, and we looked at the complexes, and we can see here in the bar graph how are the complexes functioning. The black bars are essentially normal myocardium, the remote non-infarcted zone, and the gray bars are in that infarct zone. And we saw that with reperfusion, we see that complex 1 is down right away. And that just tells us that right away we're shutting down that ATP generation. And that may be why the mitochondria swell and start to pop and the cristae are all falling apart. We saw that with the unloaded group, complex 1 was preserved, that actually you're still generating oxygen consumption. You're still actually generating ATP at this stage. And then in our ECMO models, we again saw that complex 1 was down in the reperfusion injury model. And we're curious to understand, again, why we saw that signal of a slight increase in infarct size. And we're also seeing some dysfunction here in complex 2 and complex 3. And there's some biologic, you know, hypotheses that we're trying to use to understand why that might be happening. So what we're seeing now is that this complex 1 is particularly interesting and important for reperfusion injury. And complex 1 actually lives in an active state. It drives those protons down into the matrix. But when you become ischemic, the first thing that happens is complex 1 shifts to a D state or deactivated state. And when it's deactivated, it's no longer processing succinate and other metabolites. And then when you reperfuse, what happens is some of that deactivated complex goes back to becoming reactivated. And when it becomes reactivated, that backload of metabolites actually comes right through complex 1, this dysfunctional complex 1, and it gets converted to reactive oxygen species. And that triggers the damage that you start to see downstream. And in fact, the ROS may actually come back to drive more deactivation of complex 1 and starts to become a vicious cycle. So this starts to unravel that double-edged sword and why we see this reperfusion injury occurring. So one of the questions was, what's the active versus deactivated complex state in our models? And we found that in normal hearts, you see about 90% is active and about 10% is deactive. But when we go to immediate reperfusion, this changes to a 70-30 ratio. And in the unloaded arm, we're seeing that, again, it's back to normal levels. And this is, again, that active-deactivated ratio back to uninjured control. So we actually think that at the fundamental biologic mechanism actually goes all the way down to complex 1, and that this is probably an intermix of physiologic versus biologic effects. So when we look more specifically at reperfusion alone, complex 1 is down and ATP production is down, but we see that the downstream readout is that complex 1 is intact with unloading and that ATP generation, the proton-driven motor pump, is still functioning and generating ATP. And in fact, the ROS activity is up here for reperfusion, but we're shutting down that oxidative stress as soon as we unload the ventricle. And I think that's a critically important point for this space, primarily because we're now beginning to see some of the translation of this work. So this background starts to explain why we started to pursue a lot of this work with primary unloading. And we saw that 30 days later, the scar size in these preclinical models was also reduced by 50%, a durable effect, but the ventricular function was actually quite preserved compared to some dysfunction there in the no-pump arm. So the ultimate question was, so what? How do we begin to translate this? And is this going to impact our patients? And we bring it back to the patient again for this concept. And we had to perform a clinical trial. But you saw the history of trials in this space. You saw IABP. You saw the TRIST trial, which had zero enrollment. And the question is, will physicians actually do this? Will they participate? Can we do this? And this actually is feasible. And so one of the ideas was, when we looked at our preclinical models, we found that there is a kinetics component to it, that actually with 15 minutes of unloading before reperfusion, there's some effect, but really a very durable and more consistent effect was with 30 minutes of unloading before reperfusion, whether it's collateral flow index, complex 1 stabilization. These are the questions. And so before doing the pivotal, we embarked on a pilot. And the pilot was really just simply to ask the question is, can we do a trial? And can you actually do this without triggering a huge issue on vascular safety, et cetera? And so this was the door to unload STEMI pilot study design. You may be familiar with this. It's very similar to CRISP AMI, anterior STEMIs. They come in, they get unloaded with an Impella device, and then they're randomized to immediate reperfusion, which means within about 15 minutes, or this 30 minutes of mandatory unloading followed by reperfusion. And what we found was that in these 50 patients randomized, 25 in each arm, we looked at the CMR readouts at 3 to 5 days and 30 days. We started, first of all, by just seeing operator behavior, and that actually a lot of operators were willing to do the unloading. And that means that they could bail out at any point, but that their patients, at least when they're talking to them, were beginning to feel better or were stable on pump while we're in this 30 minutes of conditioning phase. And compared to the immediate arm, you can again see there's a broader standard deviation. Some actually went into the 30 minutes due to delays in terms of access, et cetera. We then also saw that in the small study that actually there was no major signal of 30-day MACE, which was really important for us. But vascular events, again, for acute MCS is going to become a very common denominator. And if you have vascular AEs, that's a big problem. And these were actually both at the time of device removal, and these were instead of at the time of device insertion. So it talks about best practices for managing vascular access for removal. So both arms of the UNLOAD pilot study actually had LV infarcts down to about 10 to 15%, and that's compared to the control arm of CRISP AMI, which was around 37%. So at least we started to see at least some early signal that perhaps this is actually another way to potentially protect the patient in an anterior MI and prevent them from developing that massive infarct. And more specifically in the delay arm, we started seeing, this is again subgroups, but we started seeing the larger patient, larger infarcts, that actually we were getting a little bit more benefit with the conditioning arm. And that's shown here, where as the ST elevation started to rise across the EKGs, that actually with the unloading and delay arm, you're seeing a very nice flat, consistent effect on infarct size versus this increase. Now, Holger Thiele brought up this great point at the AHA late breaker about ischemic time. And so we went back and looked more closely at ischemic time. So if you remember from the preclinical studies, we had imposed an additional period of unloading mandate on the Impella arm in our preclinical work. And just by random chance, the unload and delay arm had about 30 minutes of higher symptom onset to unload time, just by random chance. But remember, then we imposed an additional 30 minutes of waiting before reperfusion. And so this was actually 64 minutes, if you believe the LAD is causing ischemia at that point, of ischemic symptom time. And so what we should have seen with that increase in 60%, if you follow the Tarantini curve, is a significant increase in the infarct size. That's what we've all been taught, is that every 30-minute delay should drive that infarct up. But in fact, what we found was, instead of seeing this jump up, we saw a significant decrease. And so this starts to tell us that maybe the physiology and the biology of unloading is starting to drive this change in the actual trajectory of the patient's life with an acute MI. So the RCT is in development. We anticipate a launch in 2019, and this should be coming up in the next few months, comparing door-to-balloon standard of care versus door-to-unload as a reperfusion therapy concept. So ultimately, our goal is to try to get this patient back onto that elastic phase and recover and start to prevent heart failure as card-carrying interventionalists, which is not something that we were taught to do. I'm going to end for 5 minutes on one last concept that I'm going to introduce to you guys. You guys may be engaging in this trial, so I want to make sure we're familiar with it. But one of the things that we've also been working on the lab is this concept of preload. And so preload gets back to the Frank Starling mechanism, which you're all quite familiar with. But in heart failure, one of the things that happens is that as you start to become more congested, you actually start to see a reduction in cardiac output. Stroke volume starts to come down, this concept of the downslope of the Frank Starling mechanism. And we know from fundamental treatment that preload is critically important. This is a nice paper from Cooper and Joe Rogers, basically looking at acute heart failure patients, showing that patients who are less likely to die or have a cardiac event in hospital, it really actually wasn't driven by their cardiac index. It was more driven by their filling pressures, right atrial pressure, left atrial pressure. So congestion was as important as cardiac output. And this other paper by Marshall Brinkley and Rob Kosiel starts to hit home this point, that actually right atrial pressure is an independent predictor of in-hospital mortality. And in fact, for every 1 millimeter increase in your right atrial pressure, there's about a 12% increase in in-hospital mortality, which is a pretty astounding number. So for many years, along with the Sinagawas and all of the PV loopologists, we've been performing IVC occlusion as a way to measure end-systolic pressure volume relationships. And what you can see here is that the pressure volume area actually shrinks down to almost zero. So if you could sustain this condition, you actually would have very little cardiac work at that point. And so when we started looking at this from a therapeutic perspective, the IVC returns about two-thirds of venous return. The SVC returns about one-third. And the question was, can we actually perform an unloading effect with a very simple device-based approach in the SVC? And so this concept of therapeutic SVC occlusion was one that we started to test in the preclinical labs. And this basically shows that when you start to reduce preload, you again can reduce that pressure volume area pretty effectively. And so we've done extensive preclinical testing. This is looking at IVC occlusion, But with SVC occlusion, we see something very different. The pressure volume loop actually doesn't reduce its pressure, but its systolic pressure, but you actually get a very nice reduction in diastolic pressure. And that's some of the early findings that we started to learn about SVC versus IVC occlusion. And so here's an example of one of the videos from the lab. This is actually the unloading effect of just simply inflating a balloon in the SVC and deflating it. And you start to see this pretty profound unloading effect just by reducing that preload by about one-third in the ventricle. So we've been studying this now more intently is whether we should do IVC or SVC. And one of the advantages of SVC is it doesn't increase any of the abdominal venous pressure. And that's critically important for our heart failure patients. So we did a clinical proof of concept study. This was in patients where we tested transient SVC occlusion using an endovascular Cota balloon in the cath lab with patients who are in hospital with acute heart failure who are referred for a right heart cath. And so this is the SVC Cota balloon that's inflated, and it basically temporarily occludes flow for about 5 minutes, and then in a second cohort, we repeated it for about 10 minutes of SVC occlusion. And the question was, would patients tolerate this? Can they actually tolerate having their SVC occluded for a period of minutes? And so this is just the venograms before and after. And what we found was hemodynamically, if you look at mean PA pressure, wedge pressure, and RA pressure, within about 2 to 3 minutes, these pressures significantly come down. And so this immediate unloading effect of rapid unloading just by regulating preload. Now, one of the questions was their jugular vein pressure goes up. And so the question is that tolerated or not? And so we actually have some more data coming out, and this will be published in the next month or so, looking at these patients. But hemodynamically, we see a very nice unloading effect targeting preload, which is one of the first devices that's actually starting to go after that concept, and a very consistent effect on right-sided, left-sided mean PA pressures with sustained mean arterial pressures and actually sustained cardiac output, no reduction in cardiac output with this preload approach. So what you'll see here, and the reason we're bringing this up, is that Peter and I have been talking about this clinical trial. It's an FDA EFS study that we're engaged in, looking at a balloon mounted on a standard PA catheter and this concept of intermittent SVC occlusion, very much like a balloon pump, but actually in a much more gentler way, but on the venous side. And essentially, this balloon, this PA catheter with this SVC system will essentially give you a readout of right atrial IJ pressures to give you a sense of whether you're unloading or not, and you're still collecting all of the PA catheter data. So this Venus HF trial is one that you may be hearing more about in the coming months. This is an FDA EFS study for the preCARDIA device for SVC occlusion as a way to acutely decongest patients who are coming in with congestive heart failure without cardiogenic shock. So if you're interested in cardiac unloading and recovery and all of the stuff we talked about today, please join us. Every year we have an eight-year meeting. There are abstracts, there are poster sessions, there are oral presentations, and there's funding to attend the meeting. We usually do it with ESC or with AHA. So this year, last year we did AHA, next year it's at ESC, which will be in Paris in August. So if you are interested in participating, please let me know. I'd love to have you join us and show some of your science as well around mechanical support and load. So thanks very much for your attention. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Pat. That was a wonderful talk. I'm just curious about if you make any comments on the perfusion injury and the concept of preconditioning and any role played in.
Yeah, it's a great question. So the pioneering work in this field of cardioprotection, especially as it relates to device-based approaches, was with preconditioning, remote ischemic conditioning, and post-conditioning. So preconditioning, I think, is a great idea. The issue with preconditioning is that, again, you have to get to those patients quite early if you're going to precondition before this persistent occlusion. And so very similar biologic pathways seem to be activated. The risk pathway is what was actually identified through these techniques of conditioning through balloon occlusion. And that actually seems to be operative in the unloading state. Problem is that a lot of the trials actually haven't panned out. But more importantly, I'm less concerned about the trials because that's usually a trial design issue. But more importantly is if you think about the fundamental technique, in order to condition by inflating and deflating a balloon in the coronary vessel, what you're actually doing is an intermittent and graded reperfusion. And so we still think that actually the fundamental core concept of coronary conditioning, that you're still triggering reperfusion injury, you may just be doing it in a graded manner. And so that I think has some potential, What we're trying to go after is just leaving that, you know, reperfusion cascade silent while we try to tackle the underlying problem so that the ventricle is sort of primed and ready for reperfusion when it's time to reperfuse that vessel. So some similarities, but also some differences in terms of the approaches.
Oh, sorry. Excellent talk and beautiful work that you have done. I have a couple questions. One is in regards, I'm not sure if I got that right, but I did not see, can you comment on, please, what the effect of unloading into the microvascular obstruction? Whether do we know what is the effect on down that? And also wearing a different hat on the structural valve space, you know, can we import some of these novel discoveries that you have done into how to best treat and manage these patients and put in new valves, particularly mitral?
Yeah, I think those are two really great questions. So the first question on microvascular obstruction, so we're really interested in the MVO question because it is a it's a metric that directly links to clinical outcomes, in acute MI especially. And so we've also seen that there's actually a very nice reduction in MVO in our MRI models from the preclinical space as well as the clinical space with the pilot study. Now, it's a pilot study, so we can't really make any firm comments about MVO beyond what we're observing and comparing to historic controls. So we're hopeful that it pans out. One thing that's important along those lines is this concept of no reflow. So we also see that about, and I think at the AHA there was also a very nice paper that came out around the same time, that about 20% of MIs are going to still have impaired reflow, whether it's TIMI-1, TIMI-2 reflow, even after epicardial revascularization, getting to that microvascular obstruction comment. And what we actually found was that we had TIMI-3 flow in 100% of patients who were unloaded in the DTU study. And it's correlated with that reduction in MVO. And also, if you look at those preclinical, you know, hamburger slices where you're looking at the infarct itself, the fact that we're seeing those pockets of red interspersed and disrupting the transmural nature of an infarct tells us also we think we're getting to the microvasculature. And the collateral flow studies we did, we're starting to get to that point that we think that we're opening up this microvasculature, especially in the setting of an ischemic burden where coronary autoregulation is uncoupled by being ischemic. So there's a lot of work to be done in that space we're very curious about. Your second question about the idea of using this in the valvular space, I think is a great one. And there's no question that anytime we impose a load, you can expect that fundamental principle of wall stress, you're going to expect some injury. And so whether this leads to those cardiac standstills, those stone hearts, that phenomena that we see in the OR or you may see in the cath lab on rare occasion, I think it's still that question of how are those mitochondria handling that load. The issue, I think, is that clinically, you know, as you guys know, you're getting so good at deploying the valves, you know, that the amount of time you're spending, you know, sitting there with imposing load on the ventricle is actually getting smaller and smaller and smaller. But in those complex cases where you think you're going to have to do more work in terms of imposing load, I think this may be potentially beneficial. And again, I think it's also very important to understand that this concept of unloading is device agnostic. You know, the PHP device could do the same thing. Any pump that can effectively reduce wall stress and sustain systemic perfusion probably will achieve the same biologic effect. That's at least my postulate, but we'll see. Yep.
Going back to your you know, your slide on complex one, reactive oxygen species and ischemic reperfusion injury, I wonder if you had any comment on the recent FDA approval of that Ferox device where you're infusing hyperoxygenated blood after reperfusion.
Yeah.
And supposedly they get a significant reduction in infarct size. Just wondering how. What do you make of that?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. And, you know, the latest SSO2 data that came out, I mean, some of the preclinical data was very supportive. I think it really depends because, you know, we're now beginning to do more and more things to that reperfusion cascade. What they're targeting with supersaturated oxygen is a little bit different. It's not the same as oxidative stress. What they're actually doing now is trying to get down to the mitochondrial level and see if they can actually change redox balance. So it's not as simple as we're going to give oxygen and so we're going to improve supply to the territory. And, you know, the supersaturated oxygen, you know, story, I think is also the mechanism of it is sort of less clear. So I'll be honest with you, I don't fully understand it. I've heard it a few times from folks, but I'm still kind of figuring it out and how it fits into our model, or if it fits at all. It may be a completely different mechanism, but it still remains unclear to me. What we've been focused on is this question of how coronary perfusion and ventricular wall stress are linked together, and how SSO2 leads to that. You know, it still remains open to me. I'm not sure yet. Yeah, it's a great question. We're seeing more reperfusion therapies actually start to fall to the wayside on the drug side, and we're now seeing these device-based approaches start to pick up. But I'm still not sure about the coronary side of it. Yeah.
That's sort of maybe a naive but basic physiology question. So if I understand the premise of your work is that you want to reduce the oxygen consumption at the time of reperfusion, but, you know, with respect to the oxygen consumption of these ischemic cells are not contracting, so how does wall stress play into the oxygen consumption of non-contractile cells versus the ones that are actually contracting?
Yeah, so, you know, so I think this is partly related to a timing element. It's also partly related to why are they not contracting and how far have you been sitting in that no gradient zone in the mitochondria. And so, as we said, there is a time continuum of reversibility, and then it transfers over to irreversibility. And we know that transfer over to irreversibility is driven in a fast-forward mechanism through several pathways by reperfusion. So even though the myocytes may not be contracting, the mitochondria may actually still be intact and are potentially salvageable at that point. And so I think if you were to take a patient who's been sitting around for 12 hours of coronary occlusion or coronary ischemia, you know, it's unlikely that you're going to get to that salvage point. The salvage starts to diminish at that point. So this really does get to a timing element. If you get the patients within an hour of symptom onset, then you should expect full recovery at that point, even though they may come in with a hypokinetic ventricle. So contraction and reversibility and salvage, you know, I don't think they necessarily go hand in hand unless you start to get to the later phases of ischemic burden, in which case now you get to the irreversible plastic region of that cascade. Yeah.
And we have a question from Dr. Tim Burke from our doctor office. And Dr. Burke, I think we can hear you if you want to ask the question. Maybe not, so I will ask it. Is there pharmacology that can do the same thing?
A great question. So we're excited about the pharma space. There is unfortunately a huge graveyard of drugs that have been attempted, going all the way to cyclosporin, to more recently some of the work with Bendavia and some of the more targeting mitochondrial drugs. Beta blockers, I think, have been shown more recently to have some promise in terms of upstream use of beta blockers in acute MI. The problem with the drugs that target hemodynamic or ventricular physiology is that you could also trigger an acute heart failure and worsening ventricular function. The problem with the drugs that have been tested so far in terms of reperfusion injury and targeting that cascade is that it takes time for those drugs to get to target. And I think part of the reason why we've seen failure is not that the drugs don't do their job, it's just that we can't get them to the site of injury in time. So these are administered systemically through the vein, or even if you're given intracoronary, you're giving them to them at the time of reperfusion. And so what we hope is that actually, even if the door to unload pivotal trial just shows safety of this concept of ventricular unloading, I think it may actually open up a new era of investigation, because now all of a sudden there's a window in time. There's a time where you can put someone on a device and you could potentially deliver a drug that's very efficacious for preventing reperfusion injury or preserving cardiomyocyte recovery, and you'll allow it to give it time to actually work before you actually reperfuse. So we do think that there's a huge promise for this space on drug-device combination. We think the platform of unloading will accelerate that science, and we still do firmly believe in some of the drugs that are out there, especially the drugs that target complex 1. And probably the best examples of that are cyclosporin and Bendavia, which are the more recent ones that have failed in their clinical trials.
On the preload side, what about intravenous triglycerin?
Yeah, so intravenous nitric oxide is great, and that's what we use clinically all the time. I think part of the issue there is this is a couple of things. One is that you do start to see a systemic effect if you start to get up to those higher levels of nitroglycerin and vasodilatation. The second thing is that if you think about it, what you're really doing in that mechanism is you're increasing the capacitance reservoir as much as you can. And that will work to a certain point. But in terms of the longer-term effect, so let's say over 12 hours or 24 hours of therapy, one of the goals is, in addition to trying to reduce those filling pressures, is to actually get to better renal perfusion and trying to enhance urine output, trying to reduce some of that renal congestion that we see. And, you know, the studies that probably go all the way back to this are all the way back to the comparisons of nicotinamide versus nitroglycerin. We see a vasodilatory hemodynamic effect, but you don't see the other effects that you want to see for an unloading concept. And also, you know, when you start to reduce diastolic pressure, you're reducing systolic pressure. And this is the first time, actually, I've ever seen in a clinical study or in a preclinical study where LV systolic pressure is going up and LV diastolic pressure is going down. And that, to me, is a, just think about that for a little bit, about why, first of all, what can do that, and what is the operation of why you would see an increase in LV systolic but a reduction in diastolic.
You mean you see that with the SVC occlusion device?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I was wondering, with the microarray data, if you found surprising pathways or areas of future investigation that you weren't expecting that could be new targets in the future.
Yes. It's really fun to go back to that data set. So the Ingenuity pathway analysis has been very revealing. We've confirmed it now again, and I love the idea of sending things out to other folks that are blinded because we don't want to spend time, energy, and my career or anyone's career, frankly, working on something that's just bunk. So what we've done now is we've looked at the IPA analysis. The top hits are in inflammation, in mitochondrial function, in energy utilization, things that you're beginning to hear about. And you're gonna hear another whole body of work come out on the inflammasome and that work. We've more recently sent another batch of samples out to for a metabolomics profile to really start to look at this TCA cycle and is it impacting, you know, substrate for complex 1 and mitochondria. And again, another blinded analysis that came back, and the cluster analysis still clusters. So now with two independent approaches from a genomics as well as metabolomics perspective, we're still seeing consistency, which is very helpful as a scientist. But yes, there are many pathways, and among the top hits seem to be in